going to ask you something, Jyoti Bhatt, that sounds like a very pedantic question, but it's something that often holds very opposing approaches and differing methodologies. I personally believe that art is something that can be taught. I firmly believe it, and as we had said, you had said earlier as well, there is a need for art institutions, art colleges. But within that, often one does see, one has experienced, you get two types of teaching. The one type of teaching that is invested with directions, with positions, where teachers are willing to kind of commit themselves, right or wrong, but they commit themselves to something. And on the other hand, you get teaching in art institutions, and I'm more interested in your experiences, and so therefore the playground becomes our own college, or those who actually have no interest in it, but it becomes a space of security. Was that something that you found difficult, or did you feel that, well, like everything, there is the good and the bad, and this is part of what it is? And other than that, in just a kind of area of thought, do you feel that perhaps by having tenured teaching, that means teachers who are taken in, and once they're taken in, they're there till they retire, that this is perhaps one of the biggest problems we have in actually having committed teachers? What is your feeling about these points?
I thought, you know, students who had interest, they also knew how to get the guidance and from where to get guidance. No? And because, unlike many other institutions, our institutions allow them not to go to anybody. That was a good thing. No? Otherwise, and once in a while it happened that some people felt bad. No? If there was somebody in students in a class where I was a teacher, and if he or she would go to other person, I may feel bad. But we still didn't stop them, no, at least. Because that was a kind of personal ego. No? And I had often even talked this way to students, that teachers are like well, no? Which has certain level of water. Water doesn't come up to you. No? You have to take out. It's only that whatever we have, we will not say no. As I had, you know, earlier, I think, mentioned about the influence of folks, stories that I had heard. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a long story, but the part was that there was a mango tree. It's lots of mangoes, but not a single bird eating it. And you know, the tree wanted to find out why. Mm-hmm. And then eventually, the answer was that mango was, because you know, we believe in women in India, people believe in reincarnation. Mm-hmm. That the tree was a Brahmin, mm-hmm. Pandit like me, but never wanted to, you know, guide anybody or give his knowledge, whatever, okay, to anybody. He didn't share it. Okay. And eventually he became this, and that was the situation. So that kind of a, you know, something which is rejected by modern writers, I think, was very useful, you know, to me, to shape myself. That what I know is not important, but whatever I know, I had no right to hold it. You know, I mean, whoever. So I always probably bored other people by telling what I knew. But so that happened, no, that way. And now I missed the question. What was the other
is,
part?
The thing is that, you know, the fact that, yes, art can be taught.
So that's,
yes.
So, but we also realized that art itself was a very abstract concept. No, so there was something which was very much part of it, no, a skill, for how to start with it. And In fact, I had even once in a while tried to discuss this with Manisha, that how the traditional painters who do excellent work, like Kangra paintings and whatever our tradition, how they pass the same skill and knowledge and even eventually feeling for work to their children, though it was in a family. Eventually, I had also noticed that government of India was encouraging this. There were so-called people who were given title of master craftsmen.
Yes.
And they were getting some regular stipends to teach to students.
Mm.
So in Odisha, in Raghurajpur, I saw one painter. He was having about 15 students.
Mm-hmm.
They were not from the painter's family or caste, different caste.
Mm.
Maybe Brahmin, maybe untouchable. I'm using these terms because it's still there. No?
Yes.
His wife, the wife of this painter, would cook for all these children because they would come. It was like old ashram, only thing that it was not in jungle. And they were all learning. The only thing, their concept was narrow. They had to do what masters did, like musical gharana. And our greatest musicians who have been most of the time abroad and familiar with all so-called modern or contemporary way of life, they still believe that you can't learn Indian music if you do not go through that old system. So I said that we must see if there is, what is it in this old system which can, which is able to teach people who have without any background and still become so skillful in all our craft traditions.
Mm.
If we can incorporate that with whatever other things we are doing, it could be fine. And eventually, Sheikh did it. He tried at least.
Mm-hmm.
He invited craftsmen, two or three,
mm-hmm.
for a whole month.
Mm-hmm.
And that continued for a whole year or perhaps extended, 18 months or so,
mm-hmm.
where craftsmen would come. Craftsmen is just a term they were used because they were, or artisans,
mm-hmm.
do whatever they wanted to do. Who, any student, not only from painting department, from other departments also were allowed, if they wanted to work with these people,
mm-hmm.
to see their way of working,
mm-hmm.
their method, and while talking, you may come up with some better ideas. That's a very good thing he did.
But do you think that having teachers appointed in this tenured manner, where they appointed and then say they're 27 or they're 32, and then they stay there till they're 60 plus, whatever the retirement age is, does that in some ways reduce the ability for an institution to move with more concurrent times?
Yes, I had even suggested that earlier system of retiring at 50 was better than, which was changed, eventually made 55 and 58 and 60 and now it's 62.
Mm-hmm.
That once, it's only for first 2 year one is very careful.
Exactly.
The so-called probation period.
Mm-hmm.
Then one becomes lazy, I know few teachers, before retiring exact date, they had leaves collected, 2 or 3 years. So they all enjoyed those leaves.
Mm.
One could get maximum leaves for maybe, there is some rule, 5 weeks, 6 weeks, that.
Mm-hmm.
So they would take that leave, come for a day, again take 5, 6 weeks. And department would suffer.
Absolutely.
So when I resigned, resigned earlier,
mm-hmm.
I had to let go all this because I thought otherwise
it would be the same.
I would get salary, but department will not get the person.
Mm-hmm.
But I was in a position that I could afford that. It's not only my ideology. I was in a fortunate position, otherwise, in spite of believing, I couldn't have perhaps done this, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Birende in Delhi,
mm-hmm.
he said, No, the Baroda is getting too much inbreeding. You know. So I remembered this. Then ask somebody the meaning, because you know, that was a new term for me then. So I also realized that inbreeding, and then I actually understood inbreeding in terms of animal genetics. So our Parsi community, in spite of being such a brilliant, because of this inbreeding, why most of them have physical problems, diabetes and this and that. And so when it was, when Manisha left, and because I was senior then, I didn't apply for 2 years. No, I said we must get somebody from outside. Somebody who has studied somewhere else. That would be better. But fortunately, all of our teachers who are, it's not really inbreeding, because they all went out and got rejuvenated or changed their religion and came back, in a way. So that's a good thing. But we still could have, if somebody else had come. We hardly had one or two teachers who were not our own student. Otherwise, they all came from. So it goes on and on. The main problem is not that they are not good teachers, but students who have seen them as Kaling before 2 years, suddenly when he becomes teacher and I am still a student,
yes,
this equation changes.
And as you say, I think that in order to hold your own enthusiasm, you should also know that you're not indispensable. That, I think, keeps that balance where if you know that you have only 5 years, you actually want
there is one teacher, because we have reservation. And I've heard from this dean what had happened when he was selected. He couldn't reply any question, simplest question. I mean, he couldn't perhaps make out the difference between yellow and red and green. I mean, I'm exaggerating, but almost to that level. And he was not bothered. He said, why are you asking me these questions? You have to take me. That kind of arrogance, because reservation system. When one talks against reservation, people would suddenly blame you, that because you are Brahmin, because you are this class, because they... It's not that. I mean, whoever pleaded for this so-called lower caste, tried to bring them up, were all from upper class, because they were privileged and they could do this. They themselves couldn't have done it. But now it is interpreted that way. So you can't, you are in a, what is it, yes.
Catch-22.
Catch-22,
absolutely. Yes. Damned if you do and damned if you don't.
But they are, I think, managing. When I see these annual shows, earlier we were all, there were 50 works, 40 works would look as if they were done by Bendre sir. 10 would look that they were very poor work, but following Mani sir, something like this. Now you don't have, now you don't know who they are following. In one of my print, I had read something, and when I was working, I had made some forms, which were taken from some tribal, or I don't remember, but I had in my sketchbook. I had for last almost 15-20 years have become this habit, perhaps more, that start with sketchbook, open it, go through pages, then suddenly something struck me, it takes me back to some other time or some place, and somehow that it works as a jumping board, and then it has become habit. So I did, and I was making etching during a fun fair, and somebody started giving me credit. So during that period, I had read this sentence. So that was also written in my sketchbook, that originality is an art of concealing the source. So I added that in it. So now people have source which are not that obvious or apparent. Yes. Yesterday, yesterday day before, there was a, in the Gujarati newspaper, one photograph of one artwork being exhibited in Tate Gallery,
okay,
which is made with 6,000 oranges arranged like a pyramid.
Mm-hmm.
So it's called Pyramid of Orange. Mm-hmm. It has costed in £30,000,
mm-hmm,
so means each one is £5.
Mm-hmm.
And people who go to see can actually buy the orange,
mm-hmm,
paying £5,
mm-hmm,
and eat. Now, that's the day before yesterday. Mm. Just a month before, there was an exhibition by Amarnath, one-man show. There was a tokra, bamboo, with oranges. Only clever thing was that he had used plastic oranges,
mm-hmm,
which looked exactly like actual oranges. But the, so the Tate one, whether people buy it or not, will go
to waste.
Now, it's not impossible that he got this idea because by watching some dealer who was selling orange, which were made of this plastic. But it's also possible,
yes,
that through internet
he could have seen this.
He could have seen this. No? So.